25 feet tall, 25 tons, and a limited timetable. The staff of the Mariners Museum and Park and our partners from Crofton Industries set out to protect the museum's much-loved walking beam steam engine from the elements after almost 150 years. But before it can be conserved, this massive jigsaw puzzle must first be disassembled and moved almost 500 feet to its new home. It's a cool and overcast morning the first day of the move. But before any work can begin, Director of Conservation and Chief Conservator Will Hoffman and Ron Hamm from Crofton Industries must first assess the current conditions and clear the site of the walking beam from the side wheel steamer Albany. Even though this is the first day of the move, this project has been years in the making.
So the rough concept for this project started around 2020 or so. Projects like this are really a team effort. We know it's tall, we know it's heavy, we know where your limitations are. We work with Crofton Industries to assist with the disassembly, the lifting, and the rigging. And so that means then starting to develop a plan to work backwards from taking it apart. You have an upper beam that moves within a lower frame with a connecting rod on one side, piston linkages on the other, that if you were to straight pick it up, it would kind of wobble. So we're gonna have to develop a method to pick them up and move those parts.
Before the walking beam arrived at the Mariners, it had a long and storied life. Following the success of Robert Fulton's North River steamboat on the Hudson River in 1807, paddle steamships became the dominant commercial transport on the Hudson by the mid-19th century.
This is a book about our walking beam engine. It includes how to put everything together for that boat. This was actually handled and used while they were building the vessel.
Through fierce competition, the Hudson River Day Line emerged in 1863, and over the next few decades became the leading passenger line on the river with service from New York City to Albany.
So we have this wonderful steamship ephemera collection. A lot of the images that appear in here show that engine because they were so proud of it. The beautiful artwork that they do for their brochures always features that side profile view to show it.
To meet the demand, in 1880, the Hudson River Day Line side wheel steamer, Albany, entered service. For more than 50 years, it carried passengers up and down the Hudson River in style.
We've got a variety of things here that I've pulled directly related to the Albany letterhead or stationery. We've got tickets. We even have some of the ticket holders here. It was designed not only just to be a functional piece, like here is when we're scheduled to go, but a colorful piece as well so that people would want to hang on to it. When going through these collections, you're going to notice things like handwriting. That is somebody's history that is connected to it. We're able to take that information and start to tie it to others, tie it to objects in our collection, so it really lets us know the full story. This was handled and used by somebody who is just like me and just like you.
Day trips along the river were as much entertainment as they were transport.
Back in that time, this wasn't just transportation, but for many, this was their leisure and their vacation. You could book those little excursions. You relaxed. You socialized with everybody else. You would have your program of concerts. So this one actually has both the morning and the afternoon concerts. In many cases, a lot of the pieces we have people's signatures on them from menus. Who I ate dinner with, who I met, letters and postcards that people exchanged afterwards, because it was through that trip that they met and a lot of them became lifelong friends. So if you're interested in seeing any of this material, please contact us. It is our job and part of our mission to share this and use it to connect everyone.
With 51 seasons on the Hudson, Albany had an unprecedented record of continuous seasons running. But in 1931, the effects of the Great Depression forced older ships like Albany to be permanently laid up. After being laid up for 3 years, it was purchased by B.B. Willis and renamed Potomac. Stationed out of Washington, D.C., it served another life as an excursion steamer before being converted to a barge in 1950. It was soon after that when the mariners had a chance to save a portion of its walking beam. These early steam designs represent an important step in maritime engineering.
I think working with any historical object, but especially when you look at steam technology and you look at mechanical things in general, we often think of the 19th century as sort of the dark ages, you know, and what could they do and how could these things work, but this massive thing actually moved and part of its function drove a steamship up and down the Hudson River. It has its own story as a utilitarian object, but then it's also its story of how it was made, you know, its story of what it means for technology. What's that cultural impact starting out with, you know, with sail, your horse and buggy, and moving into now, you know, in a very short time from, you know, sail to steam.
After 70 years on the water, the top 25 feet of the engine went on display outdoors for thousands of people to see over the next 73 years. And though this object was built to work on a ship and be used outdoors, once it came to the museum, it became an artifact. And as our conservators know well, the elements will take a toll on even the biggest and seemingly most resilient objects. So as the years went by, the conservation and collections management teams started to plan how to bring this 25-ton artifact undercover to start preventative conservation.
The planning process for this project is sort of a multifaceted project. You want to take the object apart, but at the same time, you don't want to damage the object. The quality of manufacture was so good that a little bit of rust, a little bit of corrosion will cause two parts that should freely come apart to stick. But you can only plan so much till you get into the project.
After years of planning, the Bronze Door Society, the museum's dedicated donor group, provided the funding for a large new structure that would later be home to the mammoth artifact. Only once this structure was built could the hard work of disassembly begin. Due to the size and number of objects, the building's siding will be put on only after the move is finished. Day 2. The museum and Crofton crews have collectively assessed the site and establish their plan of action. The walking beam includes several sub-assemblies, which must be taken off before the larger pieces can be disassembled and moved. First up is the support structure for the connecting rod side of the beam. But it's not long after work has begun that the team runs into trouble. After more than a century of work, coats of paint, and exposure, some of the components have almost fused together.
So some of the challenges with this project were sticking components. Well, you know, after many years of being exposed to the elements, what originally would have come out quite easily, even though relatively tight fitting, were stuck. I'm gonna have to use more force to drive a key out. And so that became some of the challenges and extra work, because going into this, what should take 15 minutes end up taking a whole day. The longer a project takes, the more frustration, the more exhaustion sort of sets in. You're trying everything and it's still not going. I think that was one of the biggest challenges of this project, is a lot of things that were initially anticipated to be simple ultimately end up not being.
But what exactly is a walking beam engine? A steam engine works by boiling water, in this case by heating coal, and then using the expansion of water in the form of steam to push a piston. This linear motion is then translated to circular motion through the use of a rocker arm and connecting rod. The up and down motion of the rocker arm is what gives this engine its name, because it appears to be walking. The circular motion is then used to turn a paddle wheel. Unlike their Mississippi River counterparts, the Hudson River paddle wheelers had two enclosed wheels on either side as opposed to one on the back. Day 4, and the team has made progress on disassembling the connecting rod. Now that parts are coming off, Collections Management Specialist McCalla Givens must tag and document the sub-assemblies.
So documentation is really important, not just for the current time period, but for the future. This particular project, I needed to really document where everything came off. And where it was assembled. We started this project with one object, and at the end we broke it down into roughly maybe 50 or 60 component parts.
But this project offers a unique challenge for the collections team. How do you catalog such a massive object?
This is gonna go hopefully back together. We decided to break the large assembly down to 9 sub-assembly parts, and then from there we took it and broke those down into smaller parts as we went. And then individually, every piece still gets foundational information and a session number for it, get it divided up, get a good photograph of it, and get some notes taken of it. I would go over and tag it, and I photographed it with the whiteboard, and then put all of that into our collections management software to track that out. And so we'll subcomponent of a subcomponent all of those down in there to track them.
As the days go by, the team continues to diligently and carefully disassemble the enormous engine. They have to fight for every nut and bolt that comes off, and progress requires novel solutions.
It's often a little bit of an iterative process. So you're dealing with large, you know, hexagonal nuts, and the wrenches we have don't quite fit. Any slop will enable edges to get bent or damaged. So the best way to do that is to make a custom tool that fits over the nut. At the laboratory at the Benton Conservation Complex here, we have a full fabrication shop. So as we're actually executing the project, I had the ability to go back and modify those tools. We had these keys that held bearings together that were locked in quite tightly. And so with experiences with hydraulic tools and equipment, I basically re-engineered a tool that would use on monitor to kind of to attempt to do the same job on the walking beam.
The final day has arrived. Through iteration and problem solving, the crew has finally stripped enough of the supports so the walking beam and A-frame can be lifted and moved almost 500 feet into its new home. The process is slow and arduous.
So in moving something that's big, heavy, potentially awkward, you want to make sure that you've controlled all the variables, and so there has to be quite a bit of coordination. So you've got the person running the crane, you have people holding guidelines, you have to know from point A, from point B, where the object is going, and all of that has to be communicated. So having trained professionals who really understand that is paramount.
The crew take care to delicately maneuver every piece into the covered holding area. What originally was hoped to take 3 days ended up taking weeks. Even though this project was a challenge, it highlights the museum's commitment to collection stewardship. Without the support of our community, projects like this wouldn't be possible.
What projects like this highlight is that we need community support, and that's obviously financial, but it's also expertise. Having people come at a project from a different lens, you see that eventually it becomes an ownership to them. You know, they're becoming part of the story. You can almost watch that happen, and that's always a joy to see, because you get this buy-in over time and that investment, because they ultimately will see their legacy in it. As a museum, we talk about being connected. You literally watch the connection happen almost in real time.
But now that all the pieces are cataloged and undercover, the conservation team can start their long and painstaking process, so so these artifacts can be cherished for another 150 years to come.
What's next for the walking beam engine is us trying to figure out a manageable way to start conservation treatment.
Assess its condition, really understand what's original, what has been overpainted, repainted, that kind of thing, to understand what our plan is and how we're going to conserve it. But one outcome from the move and the investment in this project is helping to inspire thinking about how do we interpret them, how do we develop the story. And so as we work through the planning for its conservation, we're now also starting to think about how do we interpret these things, which will help us to understand and guide the conservation to help us to tell its story.
Even though the Albany's walking beam is temporarily off display, guests can view a model of the engine design in the museum's ship model gallery. While you are here, you can explore the evolution of marine steam engine designs and get a better understanding of the walking beam's place in history.
You know, if we're looking at the walking beam as kind of that beginning of the marine steam age, the walking beam really is the start of that. And then at the museum, we also have Monitor's propulsion engine, which is a trunked engine, which is sort of the next iteration or moving along the progression of steam technology. And then that leads us into expansion engine, which is sort of the last piston-driven engine in marine propulsion. But then we've also got models of turbine engines, which are really that next generation. Because if we think about it, a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier submarine, that's a steamship. So the technology changes in terms of how we're making steam propulsion, even though this is a steamship, it's a beam, it's an old engine, it has a connection to today. Somebody today who's at, you know, a shipyard working on building the next aircraft carrier, or somebody who's out there on a submarine, you know, who's working on these things, there's still a connection to them through this object. Their history is this object's history, and we're able to tell that story here.
What connections will you discover here at the Mariners Museum and Park? Be sure to like and subscribe. For more conservation action, click here.